Dearly beloved, we're gathered here today.
There's nothing like thinking about you and your love forever. But you better start thinking now, cause that's a real long time together. No primacy, no family, but it's a dream come true. Cause it's a mystery that a girl like that could fall for you. This is the scariest and greatest thing to happen to.
Hey, good morning, everyone. How incredible was worship right now? It is well within my soul, and I'm glad to be back. We had an incredible time. A bunch of us went down to Dallas to C3 Conference, and exactly, I mean, we just had a really good time and got our spirits filled up and learned so much. And you know, it's open to everybody. It's not a select few that get to go. Anyone is able to go when we go down there. And we have already acquired some spots for next year. So keep that on your radar for next year, because you don't want to miss the opportunity to go down there. Now, as for me, I know that I'm thankful for the experience there. But just like any time I ever leave for anything, I'm always glad to be home. I'm always glad to be home with the people that God has called me to lead, the people that God has put in my life. And I'm thankful for each of you. And if you're new here today, if you've never been here, if you're a guest, I'm thankful for you too. I'm thankful for the opportunity today to be able to speak to you, to share what God has put on my heart as we look at this most important of topics: love, marriage, finding the right person, being the right person for the right person. And I know that today we're in the middle of a study. It's a 5-week study of the Song of Songs, the Song of Solomon. And we started looking through it last week, and today we're going to continue going through it. And, you know, that really is the greatest love song ever. And some of you will recall even last week if you were here. I mean, there's some really good stuff in there that will kind of make you go, woo! We even came across a verse that I really didn't even want to attempt to break down to people. I just felt like, hey, let God speak to you however he wants on that, all right? We're not gonna dissect that. And we'll see lots of those things in this love song, because it's a beautiful love song about a beautiful subject that God has given to us: intimacy. And now I know that some of you are not married, or you're maybe on your way to becoming married, and this is going to speak to you as well. This isn't just for our married people. These are things that are going to help us in life, finding the right person and being the right person. Now, last week, we established some things that we need to do, some things that we need to have, and it all starts with, who will remember, godly character. Godly character. We need godly character. Relationships shouldn't be built on a foundation of trust. They should be built on a foundation of godly character. And when you have godly character, the trust will come from that. So you need to establish in your own life godly character so that you are trustworthy, and there can be trust in your relationship. And so we saw building trust comes after that godly character. We also talked about having higher standards, and that was for the marrieds and the singles. For the marrieds, making sure that we're doing things that honor God, and for the singles, making sure that we're not doing things that dishonor God. We want to have higher standards. We don't want to do everything that the rest of the world is doing. We want to do what God has called us to do. And then we talked about encouraging, constantly encouraging, using things that build up, loving beyond insecurities and overcoming insecurities. And then Pastor Nathan came up and he shared how, through his constant encouragement of his wife, how now she feels so special every day because he builds her up and he just loves her, and he tells her how beautiful she is, and he tells her how much he loves her, and no matter what, she's always feeling like, I'm beautiful, and it doesn't matter what anybody else says. My husband thinks I'm beautiful, and she feels special, and he does a great job of doing that. And then we talked about the other thing, that when we do all of that, we have godly character, all that, how it ends up resulting in feeling secure. And we looked at the roles of a man in a relationship as pastor, provider, protector. And then we all committed to having godly character. Well, today we're going to continue in this journey, and we're going to look at some more things. Next week, as a reminder, we're going to really cover a lot of the stuff that will make you go, because next week we are talking about godly sex. And so I just want to remind you of that. That way, if you are planning on bringing your young ones next week, I would love for them to be in here. But I want you to know we're talking about a topic that if you have not had this discussion with them already, that dinner after church next Sunday may be a little awkward, okay? So I call it a PG-13 message, but they should hear it because they're hearing it on the school bus, and they're hearing it on the playground, and they're hearing it by their lockers. And so we need to hear about it in a biblical way, God's view of sex and not the perverted view of sex in the world. So we're gonna look at all of that. Then we're going to talk about conflict in marriage, and because it happens. It does happen. And then we're going to talk about the last week, marriages that will last a lifetime. But this week we're talking about something exciting. Man, you're going to appreciate this, what we're talking about this week. This week we are talking about pursuit. Pursuit. We like pursuit. Men, do we like pursuit? We want to chase after. We want to chase after. And so we're talking about pursuit. And we're calling today's message Perfect Seasoning. Perfect Seasoning. Because of the different seasons you face in relationships, we want to look at the perfect seasoning. And what we want to do today is change things from pursuit of what men typically think and what really culture tries to put upon us. We tend to think of pursuit as pursuit and physical intimacy. It's all about the intimacy. And so when we do that, only pursuing physical intimacy, we miss out on pursuit of emotional and spiritual health in a relationship, and that's a neglected part, and we don't want to miss that. So if you're single and going to be married someday, you want to pursue physical and emotional health in the relationship as well. And if you're married, guys, even ladies, it can't be all about physical intimacy all the time. We want to pursue that emotional and spiritual health in our marriages, and it can be done. So we're going to start looking at this, and I believe that what God has put on my heart today is really going to minister to everyone in this room. And I want to ask God to just come in right now and just begin to start speaking to you. So if you all will join me in prayer. Lord, I thank you today. I thank you for everything that you've done that's led us to this moment. Whether we are partners of this church, whether we are just attending this church, whether we're guests at this church, you've led us here today to hear from you. And I pray, God, that you would anoint me, your servant, and speak through me to them. Lord, as we look at the words written by King Solomon under your hand in the Song of Songs, Lord, I pray that you will just minister to our hearts and minds so that we can have relationships that honor you, relationships that are blessed by you, relationships that have your favor. So, Lord, speak to us today in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, there is a lot of pressure in dating nowadays. There's a lot of pressure on putting your hand around them at the movies or holding hands or getting that kiss at the end of the date. And these pressures make it to where so often we're so caught up on them. People say, hey, what base are you at? And y'all know what I'm talking about. People ask this, you know, hey, you made it to second base? And there's this pressure that goes with it. One of the things even that I teach my children is that in dating, they should be dating looking for marriage, and they shouldn't be worried about what other people have to say about what they do. And I teach them that part of the problem with going steady, does anybody say that anymore, going steady? Committed relationship. We're committed. We're in a committed relationship. One of the problems with a very committed relationship early on is the fact that when you're in a committed relationship, everyone has these expectations of what boyfriends and girlfriends are supposed to be doing. And oftentimes those expectations do not line up with God's expectations. And we want to see relationships that meet His expectations, and we don't want to just get caught up on these pressures and conquering in pursuit, conquering physical desires. There's so much more to relationship than that. So how do we pursue a relationship that honors God? And the first thing is before marriage, for those of you that it's before marriage, you're going to have a season of preparation. A season of preparation. We see in the Song of Solomon, we're in chapter 2 now. Remember, we made it to chapter 2 last week. I'm going to pick up in chapter 2, verse 11. And the Shulamite woman, the bride in this story, she says, "See, the winter is past, and the rains are over and gone. Flowers appear on the earth, and the season of singing has come. The cooing of doves is heard in our land." Where she says the winter is past, you know, one of the things me and Pastor Joe was talking about a few weeks ago about how there's a season for everything, and winter is a season of preparation where you're getting ready for the harvest, you're getting ready to plant and all of these, you're getting ready for everything that's to come. Things die off, and then in the spring, there's new life. Now, oftentimes in the winter, you feel cold because it's cold outside. And sometimes with that coldness, you can get a little bit lonely. We, even at Christmas, remember we talked about which falls in the winter. We talked about how things are magnified during that season. But we got to see it for what it is. It's a season of preparation. And without that season of preparation, there can be no new life. So in this season, there's some things that we need to do. And I know that some of us maybe have been through things where we've been hurt. And we need a season of preparation because you've been hurt in some way. Somebody betrayed you. Maybe you were in a previous marriage, you got hurt. Maybe you weren't married and somebody cheated on you. Maybe somebody told you a lie and you're hurt and you're not ready yet to get into something new because you've got to work out those feelings, those emotions, that hurt that's inside. And so the season of preparation is a perfect time to do that. Now, some of you have not experienced those hurts yet. And the season of preparation for some of you, it may be a more like practical thing. For instance, learning to get to work on time, or learning to put on deodorant, or learning to change your underwear. These are practical things in the season of preparation that are going to help you in a relationship. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
So for some, the practical component is learning how to be prepared for a relationship that you'll one day be in. Some, it's about learning that you got responsibilities. There's bills to pay. Some of you are taking on your very first cell phones, or you're starting to purchase a car. These things are helpful in this season of preparation because in this season, I mean, life is going to happen. And if we're not prepared for it, then it would cause a strain on our marriages. The number one cause of divorce in America is always financial. Did you know that? And if you don't learn to take care of your responsibilities in this season of preparation, you will deal with financial stresses, which will stress the marriage. So the season of preparation is important. For me, I don't know how many of you know. I'm sure most of you know. I was previously married. I was married to someone before Amy. And that marriage was a disaster. And a lot of that comes from the fact that I was not prepared for marriage. I was not prepared for marriage. I didn't understand what godly marriage looked like. I didn't get that. And that marriage ended up with a lot of pain. And I'm not going to sit here today and talk negative about the mother of the oldest two children that I have. But what I will say is that there was a lot of pain inflicted upon me and the children as well. And so for me, my season of preparation was healing from all of that and processing all of that. And so for years, you know, I was able to spend time in God's Word, shaping me into a godly man, learning godly character that would help me in my current marriage, which is beautiful and blessed. And it stems from that season of preparation that I had, studying God's Word and understanding what a godly man is supposed to be like, that pastor, protector, provider. And so now it's different, and I'm thankful for that season of preparation. Don't get me wrong. At the time, it was hard. That season of preparation, sometimes it's hard in the middle of it. But when you look back, you see how it prepared you for what God had in store for you. And so as you go through your season of preparation, be it healing or just learning to be responsible, do not miss out on the fact that without the winter, there is no spring. Without the time of preparation, there can be no beautiful new life on the other side. So you need to really learn to enjoy that season of preparation. The next thing is, And most of us will know this, you have a season of infatuation. Infatuation. You may have a season of infatuation. This is that time when, you know, she's perfect in every way. Now, once you get married, you know that they're not perfect, are they? Don't say yes. Don't everybody stop. Stop. I don't want to get you in trouble. But we learn that they are not as perfect as we thought during that season of infatuation. Sometimes the things that you thought were really cute during the season of infatuation end up annoying you more than anything you ever could have dreamed or imagined. But during that season of infatuation, oh, it's perfect. And look at what we see here in Song of Solomon's chapter 2. We're going to kind of backtrack to verses 8 through 10. And it says, "Listen, my beloved, look. Here he comes leaping across the mountains, bounding over the hills. My beloved is like a gazelle or a young stag." And you know, he's at this time where he's got that emotional high. He's just feeling really up. He's so excited about her. And that's why it says he's like a stag bound. He's just like, oh my gosh, I've got her. She's amazing. I can't believe it. And he's just bounding, you know, full of energy. Like T.I., that's one I, Alyssa, T-I-double-G-R, just bouncing, you know, excited during that season of infatuation. He's just full of what he calls love for her, and he's just so excited. And it says, "My beloved is like a gazelle or a young stag." And then she says, "Look, there he stands behind our wall, gazing through the windows, peering through the lattice." What does that mean? It's not creepy like Tiffany will tell you that Tony is. See, Tiffany will tell you that Tony, he has this creepy thing where like she's maybe in a room and he'll stand in the doorway and he'll go. It's not that. It's more like Beauty and the Beast. You know Beauty and the Beast, how Belle and the Beast, y'all know the Disney cartoon, how they're walking along and Beast is kind of playing peekaboo with her in that really sweet scene out in the snow. It's really, really sweet, and that's what they're doing. He's just kind of playing around with her. Now, I will share with you, and there's a rule that you need to know, men. It's the 50% rule. 50% rule. Do you know the 50% rule? What you discover after you get married, and once I tell you, I'm like, oh yeah, I knew that rule, I just didn't realize this rule. The 50% rule is, see, sometimes the things that she finds cute, like sometimes, you know, just being real, sometimes I can walk into our bathroom and Amy's just gotten out of the shower and I'm like, hey, and she's like, and then sometimes like I can walk into the bathroom and she's just getting out of the shower and I'm like, hey, and she's like, you're sick, what's wrong with you? And there's no rhyme or reason about which way she's going to be at any given time. You never know. Half the time, she's like, oh, you're so cute. And then the other half of the time, it's like, what's wrong with you? That's the 50% rule. Fortunately, during the season of infatuation, everything's cute. And that's what he's dealing with right now. Because really, who wants to play peekaboo? Really? You know? But she's in that season of infatuation. She's like, oh, he's so cute. He's stalking me through the lattice. That's cute. He's going to be like Tony one day. It says, "My beloved spoke and said to me, arise, my darling, my beautiful one, come with me, come with me." You know, during the season of infatuation, all the love songs, they make sense. You know, like every radio or song you hear on the radio during this time, songs you would never like. For instance, I'm so embarrassed to admit this. Lord, forgive me for what I'm about to share. When I heard Bleeding Love by Leona Lewis, I was like, oh my God, that's so beautiful. That just makes me think of Amy. Y'all remember Bleeding Love? I just admitted I liked that song because it made me think of my wife. That's that season of infatuation. Now I hear that song, I'm like, but during that, you know, all the love songs, they make sense. All the love songs, or every card you see. You know, you're in Walmart and you notice a card and you're like, you're just walking past and you look over and you're like, ooh. For my beloved, or to the really hottie, or whatever it is, and you just look, and like, oh, that speaks right, and you're getting her cards and all these things, and just everything, it all makes sense, it all flows during the season of infatuation. You know, when Amy and I first got together during that season of infatuation, she would want back rubs, and I would give her back rubs, like every time, hour long back rubs. Yeah. Yeah, but during that season of infatuation, you know, like, I'm just like, yeah, you know, just, you know. And now I'm like, dang, my hands are hurting. But that season, that supernatural strength, bounding like a gazelle, my hands were just like, yeah, you know, and just, and that happens. Everything is going well. But the thing is, guys, and you need to know this, and students, you guys need to know this, that season of infatuation, it ends after about 6 months. It can last up to 2 years, but it ends. And during that season of infatuation, you're thinking, there could never be anything better than this, but there actually is something better than that. Because during that season, it's not real, but it can get a whole lot better once it gets real. Once it's that real love, that sacrificial love, that lay down my life as Christ laid down his life for the church love, that realness that comes from weathering the storm together, that season of infatuation may be gone, but listen, after Amy and I lost our child and we weathered life together, we did life together, the love we have now is so much greater than that early hour-long back rub love. It's a love of two lives joined together that have faced things together and we're bonded together. Two have become one. And there's so much better on the other side of the season of infatuation. But first, it's got to get real. It's got to get real. And that early part is just all emotional. But afterwards, it becomes choice because you love. You know, love is a choice. You choose to love someone every day. Jesus chose, because he loved us, he chose to go to the cross. He wasn't feeling it. He wasn't feeling it at all. In the Garden of Gethsemane, he was not feeling going to the cross. Lord, take this from me. I don't want to do this. He wasn't feeling it, but you know what? He chose to do it. And that's what that real love is when you choose every day to love a person, and that you need to know that season of infatuation, it may fade, but it gets so much better when you get to that place of choosing to love. And some of you are in that place and where you've chosen to love, and some of you would say right now, amen, because it's true. When you get to that other side where it's about sacrifice and commitment, so much more beautiful than that early on infatuation. So much more beautiful. Now, during this season of infatuation, if you're single, there's some things that you should limit. And so since I've kind of picked on him a little bit today, I feel like I should give Tony an opportunity to come up and talk about the things we should limit during this season of infatuation. And I'm just praying, because he's pretty witty, that he doesn't get me too hard. So, Tony, you want to come on up?
Thank you, brother. Well, thank you all very much. I'm not going to get Pastor Derek, because we were talking about it outside. He actually told me that, hey, I'm going to pick on you a little bit. And I said, that's cool. I get mic time. He says, yeah, but I come back up after. So I'm going to leave him alone, because I've got a little bit of wisdom. But the thing we need to realize in this story is that the couple in the Song of Solomon, eventually, when they get to that real love stage, is they're married. And so, like Pastor Derek said, if you're single, it's a little bit different. And there's things we need to limit, because you're still single. You're not to that spot where your love has evolved. And just to my creepiness, though, if you're in love, like you're really in it, and you're not still having a little bit of fun, bounding over things, and maybe a little of that sometimes, you're missing out. So make sure you're still having fun and keeping that in your relationship. But as a single person, and I wanted to speak on this specifically because Pastor Derek gave me the opportunity to pick what I spoke on. But I'm one of the youth leaders, so I feel really strongly towards the youth, the people who are still trying to find their way as far as relationships go all through life. You know, we try to act like we have so much more above them, like we're so much more worldly and we go through so much more, when the youth, they're right there in the thick of it. And if you don't think they are, you're being a little bit naive. And talk to your kids some more, because they need you. But the first thing you need to limit is your time. You need to limit your time whenever you're with this new relationship. Who here has that friend that every time they start dating someone, they just disappear? They fall off the face of the earth. Who here is that friend? Okay, don't point fingers. You point fingers if you want to. But why do we do this? This person was a complete stranger, maybe just 2 weeks ago, and all of a sudden you're blowing off the most solid relationships in your life, your friends, your family. You're acting like they don't care at all, because every single waking moment you're trying to take it and spend it with this new person. And yeah, it's exciting, and you're trying to learn from them and learn about them. But if you can't take time to get away from that person for a minute, even if it's just one day out of every couple, you take some time, you step back, It helps you miss them and appreciate their presence more. It helps you keep maintaining yourself. You got to make sure that you are healthy. You've got to be the best person you can be to be the best person that person may want to pursue past the season of infatuation. So if you can't spend any time away with them, you need to reevaluate the health of your relationship. You need to reevaluate some things you got going on. It may be trust issues from previous relationships. You know, people have been hurt. Like Pastor Derek was saying, you know, there are hurts we have to deal with sometimes. We have to make sure we keep those under wraps. And I know if you are that person who likes to disappear, and, you know, you may be out there thinking, oh, we're just like Romeo and Juliet. That's adorable. You might want to reread that book. Six people, including Romeo and Juliet, die horrible deaths, okay? Infatuation is a strong emotion. It can also be very dangerous, and it can lead you to places you don't want to go. Never take your friendships, your relationships, the ones that are very, very solid, for granted, because when you do, that's when you're going to lose them. The second thing you need to limit is your talk. Okay? I want to give you another chance to point some fingers if you want to. Who here has that friend on Facebook who has found the love of their life for the fourth time this year, and it's February? Okay. Stop it. Okay? All your friends look at that, and they might click like, and they may say, yay, so happy for you, but they're behind their computer screen. You know, the same thing as like typing an LOL when you just kind of glance at it a little bit. LOL. Right? They don't mean it because they know that you'll find two more by March. Okay? You need to realize that the things that you say, heard about the boy that cried wolf, right? I mean, they stop paying attention to him. It doesn't mean as much. So stop it. Love is great. 1 Corinthians says that love is the greatest of things. Right? And it is very, very powerful. I absolutely love love. But you don't have to shout it from the rooftops when you've only been dating for 3 days, because honestly, you don't know if you love someone. Jeremiah, says the love of the greatest things. Jeremiah says that the heart is wicked above all things. Your heart will lead you astray so quickly. And you can't pay attention to it. You can't pay attention to your heart in matters of the heart, if that makes any sense at all. And I know what I said. I know it sounds insane, right? But you got to use your head. So you got to pay attention not to necessarily how you feel, but pay attention to the person. How did they treat that waiter when y'all went out to eat? How do they talk to their mom? How do they talk on their Facebook page? How do they talk, what do they post on Instagram? What do they, pay attention to the person, the actions. Words do not define a person, their actions do. Okay, what are they doing? And women can be just as bad as guys sometimes. So when it pops into your head to say I love you, sure, look at them and appreciate them, but just kind of rein that in a little bit. Appreciate your time together. The end goal of dating, like Pastor Derek said, is that you should find somebody that you can see yourself marrying. You need to find that person who is worth marrying. But if they're not that person, then all the love yous, the sexting, the sexy talk, all that stuff is not going to turn them into that person. So you need to set up your boundaries, and it needs to start with verbal boundaries, things that you're not going to say because you don't know yet. You don't want to jump ahead of yourself. The third thing you want to limit is your touch. Because speaking of boundaries, we have to have physical boundaries as well, okay? We have to limit our touch. Now, I actually had a verse that, it's actually not my phone, just kidding. But y'all were panicked about that phone. That was a bigger deal than having sex. Right? Yeah. My youth group is quick. I did it on purpose just to illustrate. For just a split second, y'all panicked. But if your best friend came up to you and said, man, I had sex last night, your first instinct isn't going to be like, oh, man. It might be actually to high-five them. And that's a big deal. You know, we need to be better than that. We need to be higher than that. And we live in a world where dropping or breaking your phone or losing your phone is a bigger deal than sex. Not only is sex a big deal, it's bigger than actually what it is. The expectations you set up early in your relationship will actually predicate where your relationship goes, okay? And so limit your touch. I'm not saying that hugging somebody is a sin. I love hugs. But when hugs turn into constantly having your arms wrapped around one another, when they turn into lap sitting, let's not be naive about what thoughts are going on in our heads, okay, and where that's leading. So limit that touch, because when the seed of that thought is planted, that thought can become temptation, and the temptation leads to the sin. Jesus actually said that the thought itself is a sin. So why even open the door? Have those limits. Okay, respect yourself, respect your limits, and realize that you have more to offer than just a body. God created you for much more than that. When God created the universe, he knew full well that he was going to have to die to redeem us. He knew what he was creating. So knowing that, he created you. Do you think God would create someone that wasn't worth dying for? Right? So realize that you were just worth so much, and the creator of the universe said, you know what? I'm going to make him, or I'm going to make her, and I'm going to go die for them because they're special and they are worth it. Don't sell yourself short for this one person looking at you, you know, like, oh my gosh, you know, they gave it up, which is basically kind of how they're looking at you. But basically, don't open the door to temptation, because that's going to cheapen what God deemed worthy of the ultimate sacrifice. Thank y'all.
Keeping it real in here, and those things are so, so critically important. You have to limit your time together. You do, and don't cut everybody off just because you're in that season of infatuation with somebody. You have to limit your talk. The things that we're saying nowadays, and the things I actually just read yesterday about the epidemic of sending selfies unclothed that singles are doing, it's constantly happening. And a principal at a school said almost every time he confiscates a phone. It's got that going on. And that all starts with the talk. So you got to guard against these things. You got to guard against those things because they lead to that inappropriate touch that dishonors God. We want to keep our bodies pure for him. So that being said, in all of these seasons, in a season of preparation, in a season of infatuation, in all of this, we still should pursue intimacy. Now you're going, wait, what? I thought you were just saying, be careful with that. See, the thing is we tend to think of intimacy as being physical, but intimacy is not just physical. In fact, true intimacy is really about knowing somebody. It's about knowing them. It's about being transparent with them. True intimacy comes with no secrets from each other. And how do you get that type of intimacy where you know each other and you don't have secrets? It comes from talk. It comes from talk. Look at what we have here in verse 14 of chapter 2. It says, He says, my dove in the cleft of the rocks and the hiding places on the mountainside, show me your face, let me hear your voice, for your voice is sweet and your face is lovely. You know what he's saying? I want to talk. Come out. Don't hide. Come out and expose yourself. I want to talk to you. I want to talk. And I truly believe that the reason you feel so close so often when you're dating, because what do you do when you're dating? Talk and 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 talk. You talk so much that you'll be on the phone with each other, or nowadays on FaceTime with each other. What's the other one? Snapchat. Yeah, you'll be seeing each other, and you just talk and talk and talk, and then it's like, well, I gotta go. Okay, I gotta go too. All right, you hang up first. No, you hang up first. No, you hang up first. Let's hang up together. On the count of three, we'll hang up. One, two, three. You didn't hang up. I know, neither did you. You just talk and talk and talk and talk. And that's how that real intimacy comes. And you should do that, because that's how you get to really know the person. Through that talking, discovering what their hopes are, their dreams are, what they want out of life. Is this the person I want to marry? Does this person meet the qualifications that I'm looking for in life? Do we have common goals? Are we on the same track together? Do they love the Lord? Ooh, that's a big one. Do they love the Lord? And we find this out through talking. You know, it was a conversation. It was talking that changed my life forever, because it was a four-hour conversation with Amy. A four-hour conversation on the phone that we just talked and talked and talked, and we covered so many things in those 4 hours. So many things in those 4 hours. And I knew after that conversation, this girl met the qualifications. I'm going to marry her one day. Was I ready to tell her I love her? Was I ready to put a ring on it? If you like it, you should have put a ring on it. I wasn't ready for all that, but I knew this girl, she was everything that I wanted. And it came from talking and being open. In that conversation, we covered hurts. We covered what we wanted. There was so much, and we need that. You need to talk. But you got to guard your talk, as Tony was saying. You talk about the meaningful things and not about the sexy things. And you talk and you pursue intimacy. And in marriage, you still need to do that as well. We still need to do that as well once we're married. Because Amy and I had a 4-hour conversation. But you know what it seemed like for a while in our relationship, what it would be like? After that 4-hour conversation, after we get married, it'd be like this. She'd go, "How is your day?" And I go, "Fine." Ladies, is that enough for you? You don't want fine, do you? See, in my mind, I would just want to give her the headlines because that's how I read the paper. I read through the headlines, and if it interests me, then I'll read the whole story. But ladies, well, they don't want just the headlines. They want the whole story. They don't want just fine. They want everything. Tell me how your day really was. What did you really go through? Tell me exactly what happened from the moment you got out of bed. List to me every conversation, word for word you had, because I want to know. Not because I'm worried about things, because I actually want to know. And you're like, I can't even remember that. All I can remember is I had a bologna sandwich, and I stumped my toe, and I clocked out. I was so glad to be out. Now, I mean, that was my day. That wasn't all you did. I thought that's all I did. I don't know. Talk. Remember these things. Open up and share. It's so, so important. One of the things that when I realized that Amy and I weren't talking enough, we really started talking about God, like a lot. And one of the things that happens now, and for some of you, I just want to share, you don't realize the opportunity you are missing by serving in the children's ministry. Amy serves in the children's ministry faithfully, and she has shared that for her, in the children's ministry, she's learned more serving those children and teaching those children than she has from hearing the sermons. But what happens when she's in there is we get to talk about her lessons and how God was ministering to her. And when she's in here, when she gets to be in here, then we get to talk about what God was speaking through me, and we have these conversations about what God is doing in our life, because, you know, the big things in our life is typically the things that God is doing. And so by having these conversations, we learn a lot about each other. So we have these conversations opening up, being transparent. You know, God's convicting me of this. You know, He's speaking to me on this. And let me tell you, in a relationship, sharing what God is doing in your life goes a whole long way. Sharing what God is doing. But, you know, we tend to think that because we're married, because we share everything else, that we're close. You know, you share your bed. You share a toilet. You don't share a toothbrush. You don't do that. But you share toothpaste, which sometimes, like a lot of you know, Amy and I, that can lead to problems because she's a just grab it and squeeze it, and I'm a from-the-bottom squeezer, you know. But we share everything. But let me tell you, just because we share everything doesn't mean that we're sharing who we are and what we're going through, and we must do that. Just living in a house together and being close to someone in proximity is not the same as being close to someone in heart. And we get that mixed up so often. We think that just being close to them is close enough, and it's not. We need to open up. We need to pursue that intimacy. And the next thing we have to do, whether we are single or married, protect your purity. Protect your purity. Verse 15, he says, "Catch for us the foxes, little foxes that ruin the vineyards." Who remembers from last week what the vineyard was? Our body. "Catch for us the foxes, the little foxes that ruin the vineyards," our vineyards that are in bloom. He's saying the things that would come in and destroy, get rid of them. We don't need them to come in. We've got to protect that. See, foxes will come into a vineyard, and the things that are in bloom, the grapes that are in bloom, the foxes will eat it. And he's saying, you got to get this out. We have to protect. And I love that it's him that's leading in that protecting of purity. He's fulfilling his role as pastor, provider, protector. He's protecting them. He is protecting their hearts and their bodies and their minds. And we have to do this. You know, when you're dating, I'm going to tell you right now, If you're dating someone and they continually sin sexually, that's not someone that you want to keep being with. And by that, what I mean is addictions to pornography, getting caught up in reading trashy novels that aren't doing anything to edify the believer. I'm talking about if a guy looks at a woman, you know, he glances over and thinks, oh, she's beautiful, and goes about his way, that's one thing. But the guy that when you're with him, you're holding hands, and he's like, dang, look at what? That guy that would keep on doing that, if he would compromise that way, looking at a woman with lust in his eyes, which is what? Adultery, if it's happening in our hearts, and it's like doing it. If he continues doing that, and ladies, I know some of you have been with guys that, you're like, oh, he's just window shopping, it doesn't matter. Yes, it does matter. It does matter. And if he continues compromising his values sexually, he's going to end up going astray or leading you astray. It's going to happen. Remember, those that sin together will not end together. We talked about that last week. We want a godly foundation, and we want to honor God together. I mean, do you really think you can have a relationship that's built on a foundation of sin? So we got to protect our purity. So if you're married, what does that mean? It means stay close to Jesus. Stay close to Jesus. Stay close to Jesus. That's how that godly character is developed. Stay close to Jesus and guard your mind. What does it mean to guard your mind? Be careful what you let come in. Be careful what you're looking at. Be careful what you're reading. Be careful what you're listening to. Guard your mind and protect your purity. Now, if you're single, protecting your purity, I really just have four simple rules for you today if you're single to protect your purity. And if you will abide by these, I'm telling you, it will help out a lot in your purity. The first one is, explain your standards up front. Tell them up front. Don't wait until all of a sudden you're in a bedroom alone together and to go, oh, by the way, I'm waiting until marriage. Explain up front in that four-hour conversation who you are, what you're about. Let them know up front. Let them know who you are, that you want to remain pure. The next thing is, I call this the 4 feet on the floor rule. 4 feet on the floor rule. See how Squirrel and Mama Tracy are sitting side by side and they have 4 feet on the floor. This is safe. This is safe. But the moment her 2 feet come up off the floor and across his lap and then he feels her legs, he's like, oh, they don't have hair? That's where problems start, right there. But if you keep 4 feet on the floor, not hanging off a bed, not on each other's laps, it will help you in protecting your purity. The other thing you need to do is keep everything buttoned up, zipped up, latched up, locked up. Don't let them, don't start popping down because things are going to get tricky really quick. Keep yourself sealed up. Keep that all latched up. And the last one, there's nothing wrong with, you know, like a little peck. You still should be careful. But what you definitely don't want, well, I'll just say what it is. Keep your tongue in your own mouth. Because once those tongues connect, you know, once that happens, you're about done. And everyone that's been there in the room that knows what I'm talking about can say, amen. We know. So singles, this will help you if you will apply this. This will help you. This will help you so much. Explain your standards. Keep both feet on the floor. Keep all 4 feet on the floor. Stay buttoned up, latched up, zipped up, locked up. And keep your tongue in your own mouth. That's a big deal. That's a big deal. The result of all of this, check this out. If we do this during the season of infatuation and preparation, if we protect our purity and pursue intimacy, look at what happens in Songs 2, 16 through 17. She says, my beloved is mine, and I'm his. He browses among the lilies. That's another one of those ones that's kind of like, you know, understanding what the vineyard is. And she is a lily in the valley, remember? He browses among the lilies. I'm not really sure what that means, but that's between you and God. I do know what this next one means, though, verse 17. She's saying this now. Remember, they're married at this point, and he's honored all of these things leading up to it. They're married, and this is what she says. Until the day breaks and the shadows flee, turn, my beloved, and be like a gazelle or like a young stag on the rugged hills until the day breaks and the shadows flee. What is she saying? All night long, baby. All night long, be like a gazelle. What? And that's what happens when we pursue righteousness. And next week, we're going to talk more about that, and it's going to be incredible. But in this, when he did the right thing, I mean, guys, I want to look at the men. Men, he's married, and she's saying all night long, men, you know you're going, yeah. And ladies, you know you're going, he must have really earned her heart. He must have really earned her heart. That's what we want, and it all starts, going back to last week, with that godly character seeking first his kingdom and his righteousness. We do that when we seek his kingdom and his righteousness, and we establish godly character in our life, and we do all of these things along the way through all of these seasons. It leads to something beautiful that God has given for married couples, not for single couples, not for dating couples, not for going steady couples, for married couples, something beautiful God has given us. And it's a beautiful thing. It all starts with that godly character and seeking him first. Can you even see today how all of it was about seeking him first? It's about establishing godly character in our life. And if we do that, we can have godly marriages that are so satisfying in every way, emotionally, spiritually, physically. We can have this. But first, we got to seek his kingdom, his righteousness. That's the start. So what I'd like you to do right now is to bow your heads and close your eyes. If today some of you know you have not been seeking first his kingdom, his righteousness, and maybe some of you have compromised in some of these areas, I'm not asking you to confess what you've compromised or anything like that. I'm just asking everybody that's here, if this is speaking to you and you know you have not been seeking first his kingdom and his righteousness, you have not been seeking to live a life set aside for him so that you can one day have that godly marriage, or even now in your marriage, you're not seeking his kingdom and his righteousness, though you're not leading in your marriage the way that you should, and you're not pursuing the intimacy that God so longs for us to have in our marriages. If you know this and today you want to repent of that, you want to change, you want to seek him, and you want to have godly relationships, then let me see your hands today. I see your hand. I see your hand in the back. I see your hand. I see your hands over here. I see your hand. I see your hands. I see your hands. Praise God for the people that are confessing this. I'm going to pray with you all right now. I'm going to pray with you. Lord, I thank you for the people that realize, that have admitted that they are not seeking you first in their own personal lives, which means they can't even begin to be seeking you in their relationships. Lord, we want relationships that bring glory to you, because you created us for a relationship with you, and you saw it was not good for us to be alone. So you've given man and woman for each other. And Lord, we long to have that life mate that would be with us, that would love us sacrificially, that would be committed to us. We long for that blessed marriage that stands on your word and is fulfilling in every single way, just as we see this marriage between the bride and the bridegroom, between the Shulamite woman and King Solomon. We want a relationship like that, Lord, and we know it starts with seeking you and honoring you. So, Lord, from this day forward, we commit to seeking you first. Whatever we've been doing that's outside of what you would have had us done, we repent of that. We ask you to forgive us of that. We place that at the foot of the cross. And we ask you to guide us on your path, which will lead to satisfying relationships. And, Lord, we don't do this for satisfying relationships in the world. That's just the overflow. We do this because, above all, we want a satisfying relationship with you. We love you so much, God. We love you, and we thank you for what you've done for us. So we want to honor you with every bit of our lives, including our relationships. Thank you for your word, which speaks into our hearts. Thank you, God. For some of you today, maybe you've never actually committed your life to Christ. You've never even began seeking Him. And I want to give you that opportunity today, because even though we're talking about the Song of Solomon and marital relationships, the greatest relationship we can ever have is with God Himself. And we can have that relationship through what Jesus Christ did for us 2,000 years ago on the cross. See, all of us have compromised in some form. And that compromise is called sin. And sin separates us from God, but that's not what God created us for. He did not create us to be separated. He created us to be in fellowship with Him, to know Him, for Him to know us, to be in a relationship. And that's what He longs for. But our compromises have separated us. But He's erected a bridge. That bridge is Jesus. And we can know God through what Jesus has done. We can be forgiven of our compromises, our sin, because of what Jesus has done. And we know it to be true because Jesus came from God, lived a perfect sinless life, God in the flesh, and died the death that we deserve for our compromises. He never compromised. He died the death that we deserve. And as He promised, showing exactly who He was, fulfilling exactly who He was, 3 days later, He rose from the grave. Death could not hold Him. Death could not separate Him. And death does not have to separate you if you will accept what Jesus has done and ask His forgiveness. He wants you to. And maybe you're the person here today that He's speaking to. This is all for you. He brought you here for this moment so that you could say, I believe what I've just heard. And here's the beauty of it. After He rose from the grave, after ministering to His disciples, He ascended into heaven where He rules as Lord, as King. And one day He's coming back for the people that's accepted His gift, have asked forgiveness of the compromise. So if today He drew you into this place, and what I'm saying rings true to you, and you want to ask Him to forgive you, you want a relationship with Him, the relationship you were created for. You want forgiveness of your sins. And you want to experience eternal life just as He has eternal life. If you want that today with nobody looking around, let me see your hand right now. Praise God, I see your hand. I see your hand. Praise God. Then what, if you'll look at me, brother, you need to know because of what He did, your sins are forgiven. But right now, we want to commit to Him and we want to confess to Him. And everybody, we can recommit, reconfess right now through a simple prayer. All of us now, and in particular to you that raised your hand. Lord Jesus, I've sinned, but I believe that You came and gave Your life on a cross, and that after You died, You rose from the grave. I believe You ascended to heaven. And I believe that You rule as Lord. And I believe You did it for me. You did it for me. Thank You. Forgive me for all I've done. And give me the gift of eternal life. Fill me with Your Spirit to use me for Your purpose all the days that I live. I'm Yours, Lord Jesus. In Your name. Amen. I'll give a hand. I would like for you to fill out your connection card and go to the connections room after service. We want to talk to you about what's next in the process, because that commitment to Jesus Christ, that's just where we start. There's so much more to living a life set aside for Him, and we want to help you in that journey. For everybody else, what we're going to do right now, I'm going to call the ushers forward, and we're going to return our tithes and offerings. We're going to give back to God what is His, and we're going to be thankful we get to do this. I'm thankful we get to do this. I'm blessed that I get to do this. I'm blessed that God has given me everything that I have, and I can do this. It's a joy to be able to experience His goodness through my giving. Just as Olivia shared last week, I've seen God work so many times, and I get to give back to Him. He who's given me everything, He gave me eternal life, just as He's given you guys eternal life. He's done this for us. And we just want to do something for him. So I'm going to pray over our tithes and offerings today. Lord Jesus, this is yours. You've given me life. You've given me everything. You've given me my beautiful wife who I have an incredible relationship with. You've given me 5 amazing children that are still with me and 1 that is with you. And I thank you for them all. I thank you for your goodness. And I thank you that you give me the privilege of giving something back to you. I don't deserve any of what I have. But you've given it graciously to me. So I graciously give this back to you. Thank you for entrusting me with it. Now I return to you what is yours. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Everybody. Hey. Okay, I have a couple of announcements. Today after second service is our big 201 class. We need you to sign up if you're going to attend because we are buying food for everybody. So the sign up is right outside that door on the table. And just if it's you and your spouse, sign up you and your spouse so we know a number. And then life groups are resuming this Wednesday. Yay! Okay, and then the daddy-daughter dance is on Friday, and so tickets can be bought in the connections room or at the door the night of, and we're going to go ahead and just pray over our weeks. Heavenly Father, I just love a good marriage series. It gets me really fired up and gets me really excited, and just love learning about the person that I need to become and that what I can do to better my marriage. And I just pray that this message spoke to everybody else, Father, just like it spoke to me. And I just pray that you would be with us all throughout our weeks and that you would provide plenty of opportunities for us to invite more people to hear about this, Father. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Y'all have a good week.